The Haupapa, or Tasman Glacier, the largest and longest in Aotearoa. Now, if you've seen a climate change documentary before, you've probably seen footage like this. Thing is, calving is pretty normal behaviour for a glacier, but what are those chunks of ice falling into? Water. Water from a glacier melting faster than any time in human history.
New Zealand's Southern Alps, some of the most breathtaking scenery in all the world. Amid this grandeur, the Tasman Glacier.
For decades, scientists have looked to our glaciers for information about the climate.
As humans, we experience weather, not climate. Glaciers, they're a fingerprint of climate, not weather. They respond to things that are happening at longer timescales.
Since records began, the Haupapa Glacier has been roughly 28 kilometres long. In the 1970s, the Tasman Lake didn't even exist. Then in the 1990s, the glacier began to melt. Today, almost a fifth of the original length is gone, and the Tasman Lake keeps the Aoraki tourism industry afloat. And it's not just the loss of glaciers. When smoke from Australia's bushfires blotted out the New Zealand sun, where did that ash end up?
Scientists say the ash is turning our glaciers orange and could hasten their demise.
The usually pristine white snow turning a shade much closer to that of the Sahara.
I think one of the challenges that people have with understanding climate change is that it's really gradual. On a day-to-day scale, it's hard for humans to notice those changes.
The average lifespan of a New Zealander is about 80 years. The average glacier in New Zealand has existed in its current form for about 12,000 years, when the temperature was a bit cooler than averages at the end of the 20th century. And give or take slow fluctuations, temperatures have stuck close to that level for millennia. Then relatively recently, something changes. Populations boom worldwide, as does mass production and consumption, factory farming, international travel, and greenhouse gas emissions. And the temperature went up.
So somebody who's in their 80s today has experienced about 1 degree of global warming. This is unprecedented for humanity, really.
Aotearoa, like the rest of the world, is heating up. But just how hot are we going to get?
Well, there is a lot of uncertainty about how much temperatures might rise, but that uncertainty is not about the science of how the climate works. The uncertainty is about what human society is going to do with greenhouse gas emissions.
Exactly how much carbon dioxide, methane, and other heat-trapping gases will continue to pump into the atmosphere is impossible to predict. So scientists modelled a range of possible scenarios. A high emissions future is where we're currently headed, so it's one in which we do nothing. But a low emissions future would see us rapidly reduce our output of greenhouse gases.
We know we're going to get warming, but to what extent? The average increase in temperature means that we're going to have more hot days, for example. A hot day we commonly refer to as a day where the maximum temperature exceeds 25 degrees.
At 25 degrees, people turn their AC on. Closed cars are fatally dangerous. Livestock are heat-stressed. Here, an average of recent years shows how many hot days we experience. The warmer the block of colour, the more hot days a place endures. On average, Stewart Island, our southern national parks, register fewer than 5 hot days a year. The further north you go, the hotter the country gets. Auckland and the far north average about 30 hot days a year.
We often talk about the averages, but it's actually the extremes that will impact us the most.
Hot, dry weather is every holiday maker's dream, but it's quickly becoming a nightmare for northern farmers.
Now, let's see what happens if we keep emitting greenhouse gases at our current rate. The South Island in the middle of the century could be much, much warmer than it is now. In 2075 in Wellington, the end of the century in the Bay of Plenty, eventually, Auckland and the far north could see up to 90 annual hot days. Almost one-third of every year north of Hamilton could be above 25 degrees.
the downside of having more hot days is the impacts that it has, for example, on our animals and maybe like kiwi, eels, our natural environments, maybe even pets. We can see from overseas heat waves have huge health impacts.
These kiwi are climate refugees. This is why we're telling landowners to start putting out water dishes. The heat of the day is just too much for them.
In 2120, if we do nothing, this is how hot our country could be. But what if we do take action? If we moderately reduce greenhouse gas emissions, if we manage an extreme reduction, to see two possible futures side by side is to see our choice laid bare.
1.5 degrees to 3 or 4 is the difference between a livable world and catastrophe, basically.
And it might sound obvious, but more heat means less cold.
Many places we're projecting Aotearoa to become frost-free. Many people may remember frosts in their area and now may notice that they're very rare.
Each one of the drovers is thinking all the time of that descending snow line, weighing up the chances of a mild or severe winter to come.
These are, on average, our frost days. The lighter the blue, the more frosts a place has. Much of the central North Island and most of inland South Island have at least 30 frosts a year, and some areas have many more. Again, let's compare two futures. In the south, in a low emissions future, things are stable. In a high emissions reality, frosts retreat inland. The north tells an even more severe story. Stability throughout the century versus the loss of frosts almost entirely.
Thinking about agriculture and horticulture, you know, a lot of pests that bother things like apple trees or crops die off in the winter because it gets cold. The whole timing of the seasonal cycle for all ecosystems really can go out the window. It could have catastrophic effects on how plants and animals manage their way through the year.
Plants and animals we rely on to keep us fed. The IPCC has warned that all pillars of food security are threatened by the climate crisis. In short, in the climate crisis, people will starve.
So the question is, you know, is it too late? Do we have any hope? Well, I'm an eternal optimist, and so I would say, of course it's not too late. And in fact, I would even go further to say, it is never too late. We have to be doing something today.
Our country is going to change. People could lose their homes, farms, jobs, and possibly even their lives.
If we choose to take action now, then the future looks pretty bright. If we don't, well, it doesn't. You know, that's the choice that we have to make.
The Haupapa Glacier is still melting. Every day, it is crying out for help.
How much damage are we prepared to put up with in the future?